Johnstown, 1800 to 1889 is the first of three programs prepared for the centennial commemoration by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project and WJAC-TV.
Christian Church at the corner of Vine and Levergood Streets marks the location of the first building constructed in Johnstown. The building was a one-story log cabin built by Swiss immigrant Joseph Johns in 1794. When the land at the confluence of the Stony Creek and the Little Conemaugh Rivers was still part of the great western frontier. Population in the area at that time was sparse. Few people ventured to live in the heavily timbered hilly lands west of the Alleghenies and east of Pittsburgh. Joseph Johns and many others who moved westward at the turn of the 19th century bought land with the intention of selling it to the many pioneers who would surely follow. Johns planned a town and speculated that it would become one of the major transportation routes through the hinterlands of western Pennsylvania to Pittsburgh and points west. The Stony Creek and the Conemaugh Rivers were designated public highways. Johns knew that the Juniata Valley, just over the mountain to the east of Johnstown, was rich in iron ore. The ore was cast into pig iron there and shipped through the Conemaugh River Valley to Pittsburgh, where it was made into farm implements and household items. They were sold to people who had crossed the Alleghenies to Pittsburgh and were heading west. Johns also hoped that his town could become the county seat of the soon-to-be-formed Cambria County. First, he needed to clear the land. He built a house, planted an orchard, and prepared some land for farming. He laid out his town west of present-day Franklin Street to the point where the rivers meet. 141 lots, 4 rods wide by 16 rods long. That's 66 by 264 feet. Certain lands were for public use. Land was set aside for a building to be used as a church and a school. The land at Franklin and Main Streets was for city buildings. The land at the point for recreation, and the land where the war memorial now stands for a cemetery. The area where Central Park is now located was set aside for the proposed county buildings. Johns named his town Conemaugh Old Town, although some called it Johnstown even then. The town was officially named Johnstown in 1834 and lost its bid for the county seat of Cambria County to Evansburg in 1804. Lots along Washington Street sold for $5. Those along Franklin and Main Streets for $50. By 1803, three families lived in Johnstown. By 1810, 50 families had moved in. Among those was Isaac Proctor, a shipper, who built his warehouse on Franklin Street near the Stony Creek River. Proctor stored pig iron hauled over the Frankstown Road in the fall and winter months. When the high waters came in the spring, the pig iron was floated on flatboats down the Conemaugh River to the Kiska-Comatas and to the Allegheny into Pittsburgh. Since the boats could not come back upstream, they were sold at Pittsburgh, and the riverman made his way back to Conemaugh Old Town on foot or on horseback. Farmers moved into the area around Conemaugh Old Town. Millers, tanners, coopers, rivermen, tavern keepers, and innkeepers moved into the village. Farmers forded the rivers to come into town. On market days, farmers and villagers met at the market house on the main street side of Central Park. The streets were lined with buckboards and wagons. The locals traded and sold their wares. Occasionally, a stranger happened into town with a new medicinal remedy or special merchandise. Conemaugh Old Town's only exports were maple syrup in the spring and timber and venison in the fall. Although life was somewhat primitive, records indicate that between 1800 and 1825, the village had at least four schools. A half dozen Protestant denominations shared this building for church services. Itinerant preachers served the congregations. Mail arrived twice a week. And at least for a few years, Conemaugh Old Town's postmaster doubled as a teacher in the common school. Conemaugh Old Town was a peaceful place to live. Generally, the only people coming into and going from the village were the teamsters who transported timber, pig iron, and manufactured goods over the mountains, or the rivermen who floated those goods downstream. February 25, 1826, a decision in Harrisburg, the state capital, altered the character of the quiet little village in the Conemaugh River Valley forever. The state of New York had completed the Erie Canal. Pennsylvanians, particularly western Pennsylvanians, did not need the consequences spelled out. The Erie Canal connected New York to the Midwest. Now farm produce could be shipped more cheaply on the canal than it could be hauled overland in Pennsylvania. Travel for homesteaders going west was easier and quicker on the canal. Now fewer people would travel west through Pittsburgh and buy merchandise there. In addition, manufactured goods made in New York City could be sold cheaper in the west than those made in Philadelphia. Pennsylvanians demanded the Commonwealth do something. The state responded by building the Pennsylvania Main Line Canal, a 394-mile network of waterways and rails from Philadelphia to Pittsburgh. Freight and passengers coming west from Philadelphia were transported first by short line railroad from Philadelphia to Columbia, just south of Harrisburg. At Columbia, the freight, or the passengers, were transferred onto a canal barge. The barges were hoisted into the canals, which ran along the state's natural waterways. At Hollidaysburg, the barges were transferred from water back to rail to be lifted over the mountain on the Allegheny Portage Railroad. The Allegheny Portage Railroad was a series of 10 inclined planes, with five on the east slope and five on the west slope of the Allegheny Mountains. Each incline was run by stationary engines and counterbalanced. just as the cars are on the Johnstown incline plane today. Between the inclines, the barges were pulled over a rail system, first by horses and mules, and later by locomotives. The summit of the Allegheny Portage Railroad was at the Lemon House near Crescent, the present location of the Allegheny Portage Railroad National Historic Site. The western terminus of the railroad was at Johnstown. By the mid-1830s, the little village at the confluence of the Stony Creek and Conemaugh Rivers had become one of the four important towns on the most modern transportation system in the state. What a difference it made. Surveyors came first, then laborers to dig, brickmakers to make bricks, brick masons to lay bricks, mechanics to work on the engines, teamsters to transport freight and passengers from the rail terminal to the canal basin. The canal basin was Johnstown's own inland harbor, the semi-circular body of water on what is now Railroad Street, began at what is now Clinton and Washington Streets and stretched eastward for 600 yards. An island was formed between the basin and the Little Conemaugh River. The island and the basin area quickly became the hub of the town's activity. Innkeepers did brisk business. Taverns flourished. Monongahela rye was 3 cents a glass, or two glasses for a nickel. And thanks to the canal, Johnstown had a link with the outside world. Johnstowners often gathered at the basin to watch the passing parade of people as they traveled through Pennsylvania. They saw famous English novelist Charles Dickens and the funeral cortege of President Zachary Taylor. Johnstowners joined the mourners' procession behind the president's casket as it marched from the basin to the canal. Because of the canal, thousands of people heading west passed through and often spent a little time in Johnstown. A few, like Emanuel Young, were stranded in Johnstown in a winter snowstorm and never got around to continuing their journey. The mainline canal bankrupted the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, but laid the economic base for many towns along its route. Johnstown, Pennsylvania was one of those towns. The first passenger train arrived in Johnstown on February 15, 1854. And the short-lived era of the Pennsylvania Mainline Canal was over. One by one, businesses around the basin area closed. Some towns along the canal route became ghost towns, not Johnstown. The state repair shop for the canal had been at East Conemaugh. The Pennsylvania Railroad used this for an engine yard. Because of the canal, Johnstown was already established as a freight and passenger center. The Pennsylvania Railroad established one of their freight and passenger centers at Johnstown also. There were bridges to be built and tracks to be laid. Johnstowners secured the contracts for these. By 1855, the population of the city had grown to 6,000. The town boasted 30 grocery and provision stores, 15 dry goods stores, 4 drug, medicine, and bookstores, and 1 banking house. In addition, there were 14 shoemakers, 12 school teachers, 6 blacksmiths, 7 lawyers, and 2 dentists. Trains stopped in the city daily. On the trains, people could easily come and go to and from Johnstown. Freight could easily be shipped anywhere the railroads went, and the railroads went almost everywhere. While the railroads were generating a transportation revolution in the whole country, they were sparking another type of revolution in Johnstown. Men had been forging iron in the Conemaugh River Valley from the early 1800s. Johnstowner Peter Levergood leased his Cambria forge to a Pittsburgh company as early as the 1820s. In 1840, Johnstowner George King and Peter Schoenberger of Pittsburgh discovered iron ore on John Slay's farm, just 4 miles outside of Johnstown. There was plenty of timber to burn for the charcoal needed for their first iron furnaces. And when coke furnaces became part of the iron and steel industries, there was plenty of coal. King and Schoenberger foresaw an extensive railroad system that would be built across the nation and decided to make iron rails for the railroads. Financed by Philadelphia investors, they built their Cambria Iron Company at the present location of the lower works of the Bethlehem Steel Company. However, their technology for making iron rails was inefficient, and their products not up to the standards of rails made in the British Isles. In a very short time, King and Schoenberger and their investors were nearly bankrupt. The investors reorganized and brought the now famous steel engineer, John Fritz, to rebuild their rolling mill. When Fritz saw that many of the most objectionable features of the old mill were being retained, he refused to build the mill the company ordered. Thus, he said, I consequently concluded that I would do as I had been compelled to do before and many times since, and assume authority to go ahead. The result was the three-high rolling mill, a technological innovation that would revolutionize the iron and steel industries and save the Cambria Iron Works. Iron rails could now be made faster. With a few additional inventive adjustments, iron of a quality comparable to the product made by foreign competitors could be produced in Johnstown. John Fritz was only one of the first of a line of important steel engineers to work at Johnstown. Over the next decade, William Pig Iron Kelly and John Fritz's brother George would also experiment with important technologies at the Cambria Works. This mill, used to make specialty steel at the Bethlehem Steel Company today, is similar to the mills the Cambria Iron Works used in the late 1800s.
We have roughers built like elephants and others thin and spare. Our catcher says it's all the same, our rollers seldom there. We have hookers there, all skillful men, our straighteners number five. And when we go to changing rolls, all nature seems alive.
By the 1870s, the Cambria Iron Works at Johnstown, Pennsylvania, was the leading steel producer in the world. By 1880, Cambria employed 1,000 more workers than its nearest competitor and was rivaled in size only by a few of the nation's large textile mills. The Cambria Iron Works was the largest iron and steel employer in the United States. The effect on Johnstown was dramatic. Workers from all over the country came to work at the mills. Contracted labor was brought in from Eastern Europe, and a group of Englishmen who were skilled wire drawers were recruited and employed for the Gautier Division. In the late 1800s, the Cambria Iron Works built houses to rent and to sell to the workers. The Cambria Iron Works had its own store. To supply fabrics for that store, the Cambria Iron Works employed 200 women at this woolen mill located in Woodvale. To supply produce, the Cambria Iron Works operated farms. In their store, the Cambria Iron Works supplied shoemakers, tailors to make that suit for a special occasion, and even a clergyman for a marriage, baptism, or funeral, all available on credit for the Cambria Iron Worker. The Cambria Iron Works built a library and held school there where workers could attend evenings to learn to read or write, or perhaps learn bookkeeping or drafting. The Cambria Iron Works built a hospital where employees could obtain medical care, and a clubhouse where the management could spend their leisure hours. Still, the town was dirty, and the population of Johnstown was growing too fast. Housing was less than adequate. Working in the mill was hot and dangerous, and the lives of the workers quickly became subject to the whims of the company and the economic swings of the iron and steel industries. Still, there was a camaraderie among the Johnstown workers. Many had served in the Civil War together. Their manager at the mills had been their captain in battle, and many were in the same volunteer fire companies. Besides, there was another world outside the mill. The town thrived. Butchers, bakers, and dressmakers set up shops in Johnstown to service the many people. Johnstown was surrounded by mountains. People traveled from Pittsburgh, Harrisburg, Baltimore, and Washington to area resorts at Crescent, Berlin, and Bedford Springs. These buildings at St. Michael are some of the few remaining reminders of the South Fork Fishing and Hunting Club, one of the most prestigious of the summer resorts. Such famous men as steel entrepreneurs Andrew Carnegie and Henry Clay Frick belong to this club. Famous statesman Philander Knox was also a member. They came in summer to sit at the clubhouse and sip cool drinks and to fish in Lake Conemaugh. Some Johnstowners, like John Fulton, geologist at the Cambria Iron Works, were aware of the wealthy vacationers. Fulton knew that Lake Conemaugh was in need of repair. Alterations of the earthen dam had made it unsafe. Fulton's report on the matter was sent to the club manager in the winter of 1880. The management at the club responded by stacking felled trees and other debris against the dam's breast. Fulton and a few others continued to be concerned, but most other people in Johnstown never thought about Lake Conemaugh and the South Fork Fishing and Hunting Club. In May of 1889, the town was bustling. Summer heat had not yet set in. Few were present at the South Fork Fishing and Hunting Club. On the afternoon of May 30th, it started to rain. By the next day, some streets in Johnstown flooded, but most Johnstowners went on about their daily activities. May 31, 1889, at 3:10 p.m., the breast of Lake Conemaugh gave way. The dam and over 40 feet of accumulated debris hit Johnstown at 4:07 in the afternoon. Within 10 minutes, the bustling little city at the confluence of the Stony Creek and Little Conemaugh was destroyed.
Johnstown, 1900 to 1936, is the second in a multi-part series produced by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project in cooperation with WJAC-TV.
Friday, October 5th, 1900, and Johnstown, Pennsylvania was celebrating its 100th anniversary. Thousands of people gathered in the streets of the city to watch the parade, then to view exhibits showing a century of the city's memories. And finally, to listen to speeches. Horace Rose, who was the city's first mayor, gave the keynote speech. He spoke of the community in its early days and the changes which affected its development. From the 1830s to the 1850s, when canals were the most modern form of transportation in the United States, Johnstown was one of the four most important stops on the Pennsylvania Mainline Canal.
The canal to Johnstown was finished in 1830. Alan Rose, aided by his son Marshall, a mere boy, opened the gates for the first time to fill the basin. John Pickworth was in charge of the first flatboat that came up from Blairsville and entered the town. Erwin Metz, now living at an advanced age, was one of the crew. The shrill boat horn woke the echoes of the new era as the boat swiftly passed along the first level and swung into the basin.
Within two decades, railroads would push the canals out of business.
In 1849, the Pennsylvania Railroad Company commenced the construction of its main line, and a new impetus was given for the time being to Johnstown.
As the railroad grew, so did the iron and steel industry.
In 1853, the Cambria Iron Company was organized. The story of that great enterprise has been so often told that it is well known to the audience. The establishment was undoubtedly the great factor that developed Johnstown from a village of 2,200 inhabitants in 1850 to a populous city with seven boroughs and several villages for its suburbs in 1900.
In 1900, the Cambria Iron Company had been incorporated as the Cambria Steel Company for 2 years. The plant was its heartbeat. The Cambria Steel Company had its own coal mines and coke ovens. In just that year, it had built new byproduct coke ovens and four new blast furnaces. And its net earnings had increased 300%. Over the next 3 years, its output of steel would nearly triple. The populous city Mr. Rose described now had 30,000 inhabitants. Thousands more traveled to Johnstown from the surrounding boroughs and countryside to work in the Cambria mills. Mr. Rose remembered that the Cambria Iron Works had once been the largest iron and steel producer in the country. He also remembered May 31st, 1889, and the great Johnstown flood.
This was a broken, torn, devastated community. Property of every form was ground to waste and carried away in the angry roll of the water that swept down from the broken South Fork Dam. Millions of dollars worth of property was destroyed. The homes, the happy homes in the region of the stream, were swept away in the wild roaring rush, and the owners crushed to death.
After the flood, Johnstowners buried their dead and rebuilt their city. A short 11 years later, there were few remnants of the disaster that had killed over 2,200 people and had virtually destroyed the city. Since 1890, the population had doubled. The city was sprawling through the valley and up the hillsides to Morrellville, Dale, Roxbury, Daisytown, and Rosedale. Many professionals and mill workers were moving into new homes in Westmont, a new suburb developed by the Cambria Iron Company and connected to the city by an incline plane. Johnstown's centennial was a time for remembering the past, observing the present, and looking forward to the future. As attorney Cyrus Elder expressed it,
"What are the changes which may be looked for during the next 100 years? Will railroads be superseded by some new methods of transportation? And the shares become as valueless as turnpike stock? will still be replaced by some lighter and stronger and cheaper metal? Will steam and compressed air and electricity give place to some force which creates itself and costs nothing, like solar energy, the ocean tides, or the pressure of the atmosphere? Will there be a different kind of man and a new social and industrial order?
Could he have known what the 20th century would bring to the industrial city in the river valley at the confluence of the Little Conemaugh and the Stony Creek rivers? In the first decade of the 20th century, the population would increase by 19,546 people. Many of Johnstown's new citizens were from East Central Europe. They'd come to work in the mills and the mines. Nicola B. is described in Dr. Ewa Maraska's book about the immigrant community in Johnstown. His experience was likely a typical one. Nicola was born in Serbia in 1889. His father owned 5 hectares of land, 2 cows, 3 pigs, and 2 horses, which he took with him each year when he set off with his sons to work on the farms in Hungary. In 1902, Nicola's uncle and his cousin and a group of other men in the village left their homes to work in America. They settled in Johnstown and sent home many letters and photographs. As Nicola recalls it, "They looked good and I decided to go." Nicola arrived in Johnstown in April 1905, where he lived with relatives in a boarding house in Woodvale. He went to work in the coal mines that supplied the mills of the Cambria Steel Company. Nicola was homesick. Life in America was not what he had expected, and the work in the mines was very difficult. So in 2.5 years, he returned to his village, only to return to America in 1910 with his brother to again work in the coal mines. In 1913, when the Cambria Company mines laid off workers, Nicola moved to Steubenville, Ohio to look for work. In Steubenville, he lived in another Serbian community. Unable to find employment there, he went back to Cambria County and finally secured a position at the Cambria Steel Company. In 1918, he married a Serbian girl he met at a dance at St. Nicholas's. The couple lived with the bride's parents in Cambria City and paid them rent and shared their food expenses. Nicola worked with the gang his father-in-law ran at the blast furnace department of the mill. The town Nicola moved into was bustling. People stopped at the Richelieu Cafe for oysters and at Charles Young's drugstore for a soda. They shopped in the city's 74 general dry goods stores or in one of its 11 department stores. Penn traffic with its Crystal Cafe was the largest and most popular. Besides in the steel mills and in the coal mines, people also worked making fire brick, ice, fertilizer, art glass, wallpaper, mattresses, brooms, and chairs. Women worked as clerks in the stores and in the many offices that were becoming common around the city, or as dressmakers or hat makers, or perhaps in the cigar factory at Cambria City. Married women kept boarders in their homes or worked trying to feed families on a low budget and keep clean homes in a smoky and dusty city. More than 85% of the community's children between 6 and 14 years of age attended one of its public or private schools. At least some teenagers attended the Johnstown High School or Rao College, where they learned to work in offices, teach school, or prepare to go on to college. Some young women trained to be nurses at the Conemaugh Valley Memorial Hospital. Other young women worked as domestic servants or cared for young children in the homes of the wealthy. Some teenage boys went to work in the mills or mines with their fathers. The downtown area was very different. The livery stable and horses were as much a way of life as the automobile is today. Men had their suits made by tailors and their shoes and boots repaired, if not hand-sewn, by the shoemaker.
Purchase from Wilkie the clothier renown, Ogden for records and woes. Frazier's the best taxi man in the town, Bard's for a lunch that consoles. Young's for that good Dixie bacon and ham, don't fail to pay Ralph a call. And when summing your bill, you can say with a will, Johnstown's the best town of all. And when summing your bill, you can say with a will,
town's the best town of all.
The United States did not enter the war right away. But the war in Europe created a new demand for steel, and a new restriction on immigration from Eastern Europe shut down Cambria's source of laborers. To make matters worse, in 1917, the United States entered the war, and although many steelworkers were exempted from the draft, hundreds of Johnstown boys enlisted in the armed services each week. Hundreds more were drafted and elected to go. To keep the mills running, Cambria extended shifts and sent John Johnston to the small towns in Alabama and Mississippi to recruit more workers. Men came by train in groups of 50 and lived in bunkhouses provided by the steel company at Rosedale, Franklin, and Conemaugh. Local historians tell us that these were not the first black men at Johnstown, that a few dozen had come in the 1870s to work in the tannery at Woodvale. But they say these were the first of Johnstown's black people who were forced to live segregated lives. The blacks had their own sections of the town and worked together in the dirtiest, lowest paying, and most difficult jobs in the mill. Because Johnstown's local physicians would not care for them when they were sick or injured, John Johnston was sent on a second recruiting mission for a black physician. He brought Dr. Moses Claiborne, who is still remembered for his work among the poor whites as well as the blacks in the community. It was during these war years that the black population in the city increased from 462 to 1,671 people. At the same time, the East Central Europeans who had arrived earlier were being pressured to Americanize. There were Americanization lectures for the general public. At one, Dr. C.C. DeWitt of the State Americanization Bureau advised the city's leaders that the only way for factories and industries to maximize efficiency was for everyone to speak the same language, English. And so the Serbs and the Poles, Slavs and Croatians, and those of other ethnic heritage in the city worked all day and attended classes in the evenings to learn American history and English. A settlement house was established on Peeler Street in Cambria City, where young children attended programs designed to teach them the English language and American ways. And mothers learned millinery and, of course, English. Through the war, the city's women were also called into service. Many joined sewing groups to knit and sew items for the war victims and the soldiers at the front. Some were called on to do jobs which men ordinarily did. Others left town to work at munitions factories and other cities. In the meantime, the wages for household help in the city soared from $3 to $9 a week. When the war was over, the women returned to their former positions, as was considered their patriotic duty. Special employment services were sent to help the veterans find jobs. Despite the fact that attempts at Americanization were continued well into the third decade of the century, the city's ethnic groups persisted in at least some of their ways. Roman Catholic schools associated with ethnic parishes continued to teach the history and the languages of the old country. And many of the ethnic groups continued to celebrate their special holidays. But when the Polish community celebrated establishment of a new government in Poland, all of the speeches and at least the Star-Spangled Banner and America were in English. Immigrants learned their lessons well. While they read and heard about democracy and freedom in Americanization classes, they worked for between $1.35 and $1.75 per day in horrendously dangerous conditions. Although the Cambria Works set up an employees' representation plan, many of the workers felt they worked under unfair conditions and wanted representation by a more democratic union. Everybody knew of somebody who had been dismissed from their job because they dared to complain. Woodrow Wilson, who was then the president of the United States, had set up a war labor board to protect laborers during the war years. Because workers had gained some representation and some better working conditions during that time, the 15,000 workers who struck the Cambria Works at Johnstown on September 22, 1919, undoubtedly felt they might succeed and secure the right to organize. During the 8 weeks of the strike, the steelworkers were permitted to meet and even to picket. But what actually occurred during these weeks is difficult to determine because of conflicting reports. While the Johnstown Tribune, the city's conservative newspaper, reported that men were returning to work daily, a special ministerial commission reported that the men at Johnstown were holding out well and that they were living from work they found at construction jobs and with provisions from the strike commission. It is known that October 30th, 1919, 2 weeks before the strike officially ended, a group of 257 Johnstown business and professional people took an ad in the Tribune. The ad stated that the strike, which was part of a national effort against the steelmakers, was defeated both nationally and locally, that Cambria would not tolerate outside agitators, and that they would personally see that the Cambria workers received social justice in the workplace. A coupon was included in the ad. Any steelworker who wished to return to the job needed only to fill it out and send it in. When the Cambria plant resumed operations in early November, most of the men crossed what picket lines there were and went to work. The pickets were arrested. A few days later, when union organizer W.Z. Foster arrived in Johnstown to organize another rally, he was told to leave on the next train that left town. He did. Although they did not gain the right to organize, Cambria's workers had not struck in vain. The Cambria division of the Midville Ordnance Company tried to pacify the workers by increasing their wages and offering other special benefits. On December 1st, the company announced a 14% wage increase. December 20th, the company announced the men would receive a Christmas bonus. And December 23rd, management announced those who worked Christmas would receive time and a half. In January, Cambria announced the reorganization of the employee representation plan. Johnstown roared into the 20s with the rest of the nation. Grocery chains invaded the city, and although they were fairly popular at first, the editors of the daily papers cheered when their receipts dropped by $14,000 in 1 week. Shoppers were encouraged to realize that dollar per dollar they received more for their money by buying from the city's independent merchants. A few weeks later, the editor of the Daily Democrat would sound a complaint against music and dialogue recorded for the movies. According to the editor, the new recordings replaced the local bands and put the musicians who normally provided the accompaniment in the movie houses out of work. Despite good attendance at local temperance rallies and an enormous celebration with thousands of people gathering in Johnstown's churches when Pennsylvania ratified the temperance amendment, bootleggers kept the city's police officers and federal agents very busy. 22 of the city's hotels were raided in one night, and the local speakeasies another. Moonshine was being made all over town and in the surrounding countryside, and many stills were confiscated, dismantled, and broken into small pieces, and the metal they were made of sold for scrap. And the proceeds put into the policeman's widow's fund. The confiscated liquor, in over 400 gallons was taken in one series of raids, was poured into the city's sewers. The Daily Democrat reported, "It flowed in a greatly diluted and undrinkable form into the Conemaugh River plant." The Johnstown of the 1920s had grown considerably. 88,000 people now lived in the city and surrounding boroughs. A very high percentage of these depended on the steel mills and related industries for their livelihoods. The Cambria plant had been purchased by the Midvale Ordnance Company during the First World War. In 1923, it was purchased by the Bethlehem Steel Corporation, and Johnstown became a center for commerce and industry. People from Cambria and Somerset counties traveled to Johnstown for entertainment and to shop. For many, life was difficult, but there was plenty of work and hope for the future. And despite the smog and the smoke and the continual danger in the mills and in the mines, life was good. Johnstown's older citizens will never forget the 1930s. These were dire economic times when one in every three Americans was unemployed. Steelworkers recall going to the gate of the mills at each of the three daily shifts and waiting and hoping to be selected to work. Those who were lucky worked 4 days a week. Everybody worked for reduced wages. To survive, many Johnstowners took any jobs they could get, and sometimes two or three jobs. Many used what little money they had for a train ticket to New York City, or they hopped the train and rode free. In New York, they did gardening or domestic work in the homes of the wealthy, or worked in restaurants. There, they could make $25 to $35 per month and send it back to the family in Johnstown. Many people remember buying at the grocery store on credit without knowing when they could pay their tab, and watching for food specials which were published in the church bulletins or in the daily newspaper, which groups of neighbors bought for 2 cents and shared. While still in the grips of America's greatest financial crisis, Johnstown would suffer yet another tragedy. William Rogers, a former reporter for the Daily Democrat, describes it. Rain fell steadily for 4 days. Because there had been record-breaking snowfall and March was unseasonably warm, the Little Conemaugh and the Stony Creek rivers swelled quickly. By early afternoon, citizens were concerned enough to go home from work and attend to their rescue operations there. Rain fell all afternoon, and by 8 p.m. there was 12 feet of water in the streets. And resignation set in as persons in nearly 10,003 homes and buildings hoped that each new ascension of water would be the crest. Bridges were going out, and unsecure buildings were floating in the rivers and streets. At midnight, or shortly thereafter, the water reached its height. Most people were marooned and resigned themselves to waiting it out, confident by this time that the buildings in which they were stranded, having withstood rising waters until the crest, would not crumble as the waters receded. By noon, travel on foot was hazardous because of silt and mud. Some had begun to clean up. Then the news spread through the town. The Quemahoning Dam, a giant dam located 12 miles south of the city, had burst. And scenes of the 1889 disaster were hastily recalled.
Johnstown, 1936 to the present, is the third in a multi-part series produced by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project in cooperation with WJAC-TV.
March 17, 1936. Johnstown, Pennsylvania suffered severe flooding. By the next day, the water had receded and the cleanup had begun when the word spread that the Quemahoning Dam had burst. Everyone knew the story of May 31, 1889, when Lake Conemaugh burst and rolled down into the Conemaugh River Valley to destroy Johnstown. Panic-stricken, people ran for the hills. Johnstown reporter William H. Rogers remembers the event. It was hours before the rumor was proven false. Hundreds were soaked in the cold, drizzling rain as they waited for the rushing wall of water to wipe out the city. Extra papers all over the country said the city was annihilated. Radio stations over the nation took up the cry, History repeats. Johnstown wiped out. Several hours later, the rumors were dispelled, and those who could returned to their homes in the valley to continue mopping up and clearing away the mud. This St. Patrick's Day flood was but one of many that had occurred throughout Pennsylvania. In the days that followed, the city was cleaned up and a successful drive began for federal money to dredge the rivers and restructure the riverbanks for a flood-free Johnstown. These were the 1930s, and times were hard. Of the 66,993 people who lived in Johnstown, most worked in the Bethlehem steel plants there. In 1937, Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president of the United States. It was an era of public works programs designed to move the country out of economic depression. The Democratic leadership at the state and local levels, which accompanied the Roosevelt administration, was sympathetic to the laboring man. Now, the American Federation of Labor and the Congress of Industrial Organizations, the country's largest national unions, could begin the successful organization of the country's laborers. In the spring of 1937, the U.S. Steel Company, the largest steel producer in the world, recognized the CIO as the bargaining agent for its workers. The CIO's organizing branch, the Steelworkers Organizing Committee, had been working in Johnstown with marginal success since the summer of 1936. Bethlehem Steel instituted an employees' representative plan with the hope of warding off union activities in their Johnstown plants. But Bethlehem was one of the companies targeted for union activity that year. Besides, many of the workers there complained that they could not choose their representation and that the company's methods of payment were arbitrary and unfair. An undetermined number of Bethlehem's workers secretly carried union cards. And when the strike began with the 11 o'clock shift on June the 11th, 1937, about one-third of the workforce refused to cross the picket lines.
Oh, workers, can you stand it? Tell me how you can. Will you be a lousy scab or will you be a man? Which side are you on?
By Thursday of the first week, a citizens' committee of the community business people met and publicized their opposition to the strike. By the first day of the next week, the state police were called to assist. By Friday of that week, the governor of Pennsylvania sent in the National Guard. The governor also ordered Bethlehem Steel to close the plant and union leader John L. Lewis to cancel a scheduled rally. In another week, some of Johnstown's clergy, the citizens' committee, and groups of workers who wished to return to work petitioned the governor to reopen the mills. The governor rescinded his order and the plant reopened with most of the men returning to work. The cause of unionization seemed to be lost again. But the strike activity called attention to the relationship of the steel company to the community, and a federal hearing was conducted to investigate the events at the Bethlehem plant in Johnstown during the 1937 strike. At the hearing, it was discovered that during the period of the strike and immediately following, Bethlehem had buried $41,750 in the company's books under various manufacturing costs. When the truth was known, some of the money was shown to have financed the Citizens Committee. $31,000 of it had gone directly to the mayor. 2 years later, the National Labor Relations Board ruled that the Bethlehem Employees Representation Plan was company-dominated and ordered it be disbanded. The Labor Relations Board forced Bethlehem to allow their workers to vote for their own representation. As the community awaited the election date, both the union and its opposition exerted pressure on the laborers. Headlines from the Daily Democrat suggest the line of defense many of the city's business and professional people likely took. Detroit, John L. Lewis and the CIO, a great city's road to ruins. Inquirer survey shows CIO and depression came hand in hand. Akron, John L. Lewis and the CIO. One third of residents on relief as heads of rubber industries move factories to other cities.
But when the election was finally held, the Bethlehem workers at Johnstown voted to join the CIO.
Oh, we are the men of the Steelworkers Union, from blast furnace, open hearth, foundry, and mill. From ingot mold stripping, from scarfing and chipping, from out where the slag pots are dumped on the fill.
Life was not all hardship for Johnstowners in the 1930s. At least some of the city's leaders began to look for the resources to promote the city as a tourist stop. An article in the Daily Democrat reported that a survey of the guest book at the Incline showed a large number of visitors from other states or even other countries. The reason for the sudden interest? The publicity the Hillside Railway received for transporting city residents to higher ground during the 1936 flood. In May, the paper reported a group of travel promoters on a tour sponsored by the Pennsylvania Publicity Commission came to Johnstown to ride the incline and visit the plot of the unknown flood victims at Grandview Cemetery. These were the times of neighborhood theaters, and the Lyric was opened on the 500 block of Franklin Street. Parking meters were installed in the city downtown area, and the new post office built. Dial telephones were installed. Now city residents could make local calls without the assistance of an operator. At the same time, Bethlehem began to improve its Johnstown facility. The axle plant and the blooming mills were modernized, and so the mills were prepared when England and France declared war on Germany. Production soared. When American boys marched off to join the war, American girls marched into the steel mills to be welders, riveters, rollers, or whatever was necessary. When the boys came home, the girls went back to their former jobs. The next decade would be remembered forever as America's glorious years. Everyone worked during the wars. Many people made more money than ever before. Rationing is also part of war, as many plants which normally produce such consumer goods as automobiles then produced war materials. There were a limited number of things to buy and war bonds to be bought, so people saved. When the war was over, American goods couldn't be made fast enough. There were production demands to meet for American consumers and for the war-torn countries in Western Europe. With its 124 industries, the Johnstown economy boomed. The mid-20th century was fun, too, at least for Johnstowners.
Johnstown, Johnstown, Pennsylvania, yeah. Johnstown, Johnstown of the USA. Johnstown, Johnstown, the city with the will. The city that floodwaters couldn't kill. Let's play the Johnstown polka. The city with the will.
A new municipal airport with passenger service was built in Richland, and Johnstown, with its 150 retail and 18 department stores, was the commercial center for two counties. The city had 305 grocery stores, 68 restaurants, and 36 hotels. There were 8 theaters and many social halls, and organizations held dances for teenagers and adults. A person could even take ballroom dancing from the Arthur Murray Dance Studio on Bedford Street. But the boom wouldn't last. As the decade rolled into the 60s, consumers wound down their spending spree and the European countries rebuilt. A forecast for the 20th century given in a speech by Cyrus Elder at Johnstown's 100th anniversary in 1900 returned to haunt the city.
What are the changes which may be looked for during the next 100 years? Will railroads be superseded by some new methods of transportation? And the shares become as valueless as turnpike stock? Will steel be replaced by some lighter and stronger and cheaper metal? Will steam and compressed air and electricity give place to some force which creates itself and costs nothing, like solar energy, the ocean tides, or the pressure of the atmosphere? Will there be a different kind of man and a new social and industrial order?
Gas and oil shortages plagued the 70s. And as the century moved into its latter half, new products replaced steel and technologies changed so that fewer men were needed in the mills.
This is the last blast furnace to operate at the plant. It's been in operation since 1957. The reason for the shutdown? Electric furnaces. Two of them have been installed at the plant and are being tested right now. The 185-ton electric furnaces are cold-charged and do not require molten iron. They'll make steel from scrap iron. So, today was the last time molten iron poured from the huge furnace into submarine ladles. For the past several years, this process has been repeated about 8 times a day, producing nearly 2,000 tons of iron every 24 hours. This last cast produced about 200 tons of iron, and this iron will be the last to go through the open hearth furnace, where it will be refined into steel. The open hearth furnace will be tapped for the last time in the next few hours. Phasing out of the blast furnace operation is taking a toll on the plant's workforce. Most of the open hearth workers will be reassigned to the electric furnace operation. However, most of the 300 blast furnace workers will be laid off.
New competition also decreased orders.
These plants, already suffering from depressed markets, could no longer bid on contracts in their respective areas against non-union, domestic and foreign operations, or against those domestic companies whose unions, in many instances, again, steel worker unions, steel worker locals, and operating at substantially lower labor rates than extended to the integrated producers. Johnstown simply has been unable to penetrate the critical commercial, industrial, and defense markets with its products because of its comparatively high labor cost.
Here in Johnstown, 540 active workers stand to lose their jobs, along with another 250 on layoff.
Does it take concessions by the steel workers to make the car shop competitive?
Yes, it does.
America's industrial cities seemed doomed. To complicate matters in Johnstown, on the evening of July 19th, 1977, a heavy storm hovered over the Conemaugh River Valley and dumped over 11 inches of rain in less than 9 hours. Johnstown Tribune Democrat reporter Larry Hudson undoubtedly expressed the community's feelings.
A flood is better off in the pages of history books. There, it's refined and condensed into a nice, neat little story, a package of words and pictures set tidily on pages of paper and chapters of books that can do you no harm. But there are some things the history books never told us. They never told us about the panic, or the heroism, or the evil, devastating things that water can do to wood, metal, concrete, automobiles, and people. They never told us about the twisted limbs of the victims, and the sudden quickening your heart takes when the rubble falls away, and through the mud, a body takes form. They never told us that the image of a dead child can penetrate a sleeping mind and shoot you bolt upright in bed. We never learn from the history books about the rubble, the lifted streets and sidewalks turned and tilted into grotesque heaps, how the cars flatten against trees and buildings, and how they swirl like plastic toys, bobbing and turning until they settle atop parking meters, telephone poles, and other cars. And they never told us about the mud. Mud piled higher than your head, mud that's impossible to walk in, mud that's mixed and remixed and trampled and retrampled and swirled again, mud that sticks to your feet, your hands, walls, homes, tires, mud that can't be swept with a broom but has to be coaxed and cajoled into tiny floods until it slops over the doorstep and out into the muddy street to join a river of mud going God knows where. The history books never told us about the smell. Sewer gas, so raw it burns your eyes and throat, and then the musty warm odor of brown water, slopping brown water that just won't go away. The smell of death, the wood smoke, of fires that burned out of control, the rotten food, ice cream, vegetables, wet paper and wet dogs, mushy carpets, damp plaster and wallpaper, the smell of yourself. Not a word in the history books about the dogs and cats that wandered around homeless, starving, stealing from the outdoor stoves and grills, challenging survivors for a piece of doubtful meat. About the animals romping into the water, swept into open manholes, animals shot because what else could we do? The book said nothing about what it's like to walk knee-deep in the slime while the dust from the streets choked your throat, clogged your nose. They never told us that boiled water turns dark and tastes much the way we all feel. We've read of death tolls, exact statistics, tidy numbers, faceless facts. We've heard the stories of heroism, but we've never read about the hero shaking hours afterwards, running to the window to vomit 2-3 times an hour. We've had tales of charity, stories of Clara Barton, yarns of the panic in the streets, but they never told us how much it would hurt. The history books didn't say a word about unwashed bodies, the psychological thirst that comes when you know that water is limited, the vacant stares from the eyes all around you, everywhere. And the books contain nothing about the way the sun comes up, pouring incongruity upon devastation. Nothing about birds singing as the dead lay heaped. And not a word about how your life is brought to a shattering, traumatic halt, about the fear of the future, a new city, new relationships, rebuilt businesses, and only memories of many you knew and loved. They never told us how we greet a friend along a ruined street, how we just have to touch, a lingering handshake, a pat on the shoulder, some physical reassurance of each other's presence, a small victory in the midst of major loss. They never told us about the lumps in our throats, the knots in our stomachs, the sudden realization that we really did love a city. The history books never told us these things. They just told us it would never happen again.
The city rebuilt again. And as it rebuilt, an economy that had formerly been secondary to the city's industrial base began to emerge on its own. It had only been a few years since Johnstown businessman Frank Pascarella announced the expansion of his company. Mr. Pascarella's company did grow, and in the early 1980s, he had more good news for the community.
Good afternoon. Crown American Corporation has announced the largest one-phase construction project ever in the history of Johnstown. The relocation of the Crown headquarters was made official this morning.
At the same time, others moved toward bringing new industries. The regional office of Metropolitan Life Insurance, for example, and the corporate offices of the Pennsylvania Electric Company. At the same time, the city's three hospitals expanded their services and modernized. And a new National Center for Excellence in Metalworking Technology was established in conjunction with Johnstown's branch campus of the University of Pittsburgh. A group of city leaders pushed for the development of tourism in the area. Former Johnstowner Jack Sheehan and a group of other investors purchased the closed U.S. steel plant to establish the Johnstown Corporation.
Johnstown Corporation isn't wasting any time in getting started. Chief Executive Officer Jack Sheehan predicts the product will be shipped in 6 weeks.
We intend to be a supplier to the entire United States steel industry, and I will not be satisfied until we are shipping product to Japan from this facility.
At nearly the same time, the Bethlehem Steel Corporation made a special commitment to Johnstown.
This means the electric furnace goes online again July 25th. Bethlehem expects it to be operating at near capacity by the beginning of next year. Employment in the division at that time will be about 3,500. The future of the Johnstown plant is a lot more clear today.
And the Bethlehem Steel Corporation decided to sacrifice its Lackawanna for its Johnstown plant.
Excellent news. It's great for the community and it's great for the workforce. The option was, or the alternative was, that we wouldn't have a steelmaking operation in Johnstown. Decision came in favor of Johnstown because of the workforce, because of the new equipment, And indeed, now we have to perform. It means 300 or 400 people from the primary mills and from steelmaking back to work in 1983 who may not have worked in 1983.
It has been only 89 years since the 100th anniversary of the city of Johnstown. The speakers and their large audiences that gathered at the centennial celebration would not have wanted to know the suffering the community would endure over the next 100 years. They had suffered enough and looked hopefully toward a brighter future. As they faced the 20th century, centennial speaker Cyrus Elder dared to predict the future.
Whatever the future may have in store, the mission of Johnstown is not ended.
He and his listeners knew that theirs was a rare heritage.
This mission of usefulness, which Johnstown has performed, is a unique and undisputable title of honor.
Johnstowners today can claim the same proud heritage and more. And despite two more horrible floods and the sacrifices that have and continue to accompany the challenge of change, Johnstowners today must consider Attorney Elder's forecast for the year 2000.
Whatever the celebration of the second centennial of Johnstown may disclose, and much of it is unimaginable to us, there will be no halt in this progress.
Johnstown, 1936 to the present, was produced by the Johnstown Flood Centennial Project in cooperation with WJAC-TV.